Chapter 3. A Sportsman's Bet. Rob Copsey, Royal Engineer.
We arrived in Rwanda in the middle of summer 94, when the main genocide was over. But there were still a lot of angry people milling around. There were some strange sights. I remember seeing one young kid who couldn't have been older than 12 or 14. He was in army fatigues with an American grenade launcher, and it was armed. He was swanning around Kigali with a gang of his mates, giving us all the evil looks. It was bizarre. He could have just fired this thing at anybody. You don't take it on board when you see it on the telly. That's just a box in the corner of your room with pictures. When you're out there, you smell it and taste it. You see it in a completely different way. The smoke from the wood fires, the dust, the stink of rotting flesh. It's horrendous. We started out at the airport and eventually transferred to the National Football Stadium in the middle of Kigali. The place had been piled high with bodies, and before we moved in, they all had to be cleared. There was no control, no police or anything. Everyone was just doing their own thing. People coming to try and find lost members of their families. The word was that the stadium had been a torture place and the changing rooms had been used for all sorts of atrocities. There were marks on the walls, bullet holes, machete marks, that sort of thing. So we cleaned all that up and then we moved in. It became a secure base for us. We got involved with all the other aid agencies that had already gone out there, mopping up and assisting. We were there as engineers, and it wasn't combat engineering, so that was good. We felt we were helping. Water purification was the main thing. Going out to massive refugee camps and delivering water. Some of the guys went to clear a reservoir that was contaminated because it had bodies in it. Then we were doing a lot of repairs. I repaired the roof of the hospital I ended up going into to have my leg off. How ironic was that? We also provided security for the medics while they did triage with casualties. It was a problem all the agencies had at the time. Once people saw there was aid or a medical person, they came running and the facility would be swamped. So we had to control the crowds. It was a matter of moving people into queues. They didn't know how to queue. They saw help and wanted to get it. Once they understood what we were doing, they went the other way. They were very friendly and grateful. You could tell they were often in agony, but they weren't moaning about it or bitching to get to the front. If it had been me, I'd have been rolling around on the floor, but they just stood there patiently in line. The whole experience was humbling. These people had nothing, absolutely nothing. My accident happened in October, about two-thirds of the way through our tour. A task came up. It was a damaged Bailey Bridge in Kigali that needed repairing so it could be open to traffic again. It was highly urgent, and one particular Sergeant Major, Richard Brown, was well known within the Corps of Engineers as being a very good bridge man. The night before we went in, we were all briefed and told that a bomb disposal recce of the bridgehead had been done, which meant no bombs, no mines, no threat. The next day, we went to the site and started gouging out parts of the demolished bridge. A Bailey Bridge is heavy, so this was hard going. As we worked, we noticed some soldiers of the Rwandan Patriotic Army, RPA, on the far bank of the river, shouting at us and holding up their weapons, AK-47s and rifles. We ignored them and carried on. It was highly unlikely, we thought, that they were going to try shooting at us. Around midday, we broke to have some food. After lunch, I happened to be at the head of the guys, walking back down the embankment to get a sledgehammer that was propped up against a transom beam. I was about to start knocking out this big pin to take part of the bridge down. As I stood on a girder, there was a very loud bang right underneath me. Everything goes slowly then. I'm now straddle this girder. My left leg is behind the girder and my right is on the other side. I'm thinking, what the bloody hell was that? Then, get down, you idiot. You're being fired at by those guys over the river. But then, I have a sudden sensation of intense heat. It's like dipping your toe into a really hot bath and immediately pulling it out. Except that you can't pull it out. This burning heat is now creeping up my leg. I look down at my foot. My boot is black and smouldering. My army fatigues too. There's a crater around my foot. Oh shit, I thought. I've stepped on a mine or something. It was only then that I fell over, to the right, landing so hard on my elbow that I sliced it open. As it turned out, that was a good thing to have done, because if I'd fallen to the left, I would have landed on another three mines. They were all in such close proximity, they probably would have finished me off. It's amazing that none of us had stepped on them during the morning. Sergeant Major Brown was there shouting at everyone to freeze. "Retrace your exact steps back up to the road," he yelled. And everyone started tiptoeing back up to the vehicles. Then he ran down and got me. "Oh, shit, my foot," I was shouting. "Shut up," he shouted back at me. And I did. I suppose it was his way of taking control. Then he put his arm round me and walked me out of there. It was a brave thing to do, because where there's one mine, there's usually three. And that day, in that place, as they discovered later, there were more. Once I was flat in the back of the Land Rover, they cut my boot off and got a dressing on my foot. There wasn't lots of blood spurting out like you see on TV. The front of my foot had just vaporised, from the toes to the bridge. All the bones were shattered. At that point, the pain really kicked in. I was breathing really heavily, like a woman giving birth. Sergeant Major Brown was beside me holding my foot, and a guy called Paddy was holding my hand, going, "Come on, Rob, come on. You'll be all right, mate." All of a sudden, the Land Rover skidded to a halt. I could hear a load of shouting from outside. There was a chain across the road and an RPA roadblock. These guys had AK-47s and they were saying we'd have to turn round. Sergeant Major Brown wasn't having that. He scrambled out the back and there was more shouting. The next thing I knew, he got one of them by the scruff of the neck and ran to the doors. He was pointing at my foot and yelling. I was aware of a black face and the whites of his eyes as he gawped at me. "Okay," he said. They dropped the chain and we were on our way. We drove on down a dirt road. I could feel every bump and every rock. I was focusing on one rivet hole in the roof of the Land Rover. To one side, the daylight was streaming in. It looked more and more like a single beam. "Come on, Rob," Paddy was shouting. "Stay with us, Rob." All of a sudden, it was as if I was above the Land Rover, looking down at it, bumping along the dirt road. I could see myself looking up at the roof, Paddy shouting at me and the Sergeant Major holding my foot. There was dust flying up behind the vehicle, and I could see that too. I could see the bushes and thorn trees on either side of the road. Then Paddy slapped me on the face a couple of times, and I was back on the floor of the Land Rover. To this day, I can't explain what happened. Perhaps I was unconscious, but it felt as if I was really there, high above the road, watching myself. Now I was on a stretcher being run into the casualty room, where they cut my fatigues off and gave me pain relief. They were Australians, and they kept calling me Sir. "Don't call me sir," I said. "I'm not a bloody officer, I'm a sapper." I had the amputation that day. When I came round, I was in the ward that I'd helped repair. I stayed in that place for a couple of weeks, being looked after by Australian nurses. Even though I realised I'd lost my leg, I was still in awe of some of the locals who'd been injured. There was a boy there who got shrapnel to the head from a mortar round. He'd lost an eye, but he was the happiest kid around. There were many others in the ward who were in a much worse state than me. It made me think, okay, you've got to deal with this now, Mush. Crack on with it. Peter Inge, the chief of the defence staff, was there at the time, and he himself came to see me. He told me he was very sorry about what had happened. If there was anything he could do, he said, I should let him know. He wrote to my mum as well. It was very good of him to do that. But much later, I heard a rumour about the whole incident, that there had been a sportsman's bet between Inge and Brown. Inge had apparently said that if Brown could build the bridge within 24 hours, he would send a magnum of champagne to his mess. I always wondered if this was true and if the mine that injured me had been overlooked as a result. There were no complications with my amputation, no secondary infections or anything. So after a fortnight, I had a second operation to close the stump and I was flown home. I went with a guy called Captain Button, who was going back because his wife had died. He was supposed to be looking after me, I think, but he was equally shell-shocked because his world had crumbled too. We flew to Mombasa in an Italian Air Force military plane. Then we did the rest of the journey on British Airways. We were like this odd couple wandering around Mombasa International Airport. I was wearing a KSB walking boot on my good foot, a pair of jeans and a 9-para squadron sweatshirt. That and a pair of crutches I'd been given. Captain Button was in similar garb. We'd just come out of an operational theatre, and we were minging. I was about 7 stone, and Button was miserable as sin. The looks we were getting were comical. People avoided us. We then found ourselves in club class. Two stinking, scruffy soldiers in a cabin full of business people in suits, all immaculate. I couldn't bend my knee, so I had to ask the guy in front not to recline his seat. "Where the hell have you two come from?" he asked. So we told him. He and his colleague were gobsmacked. They didn't even know the Brits were in Rwanda. Back in the UK, I spent a month in Woolwich Military Hospital. Then I went to Headley Court. It was very different then from how it is now. The last major war had been Gulf War I, which was very light on casualties. Most of the guys there got injured through sport or accidents at work. But I met other amputees, including Jamie Gillespie. He'd been in nine para as well, and had had a motorcycling accident. It was a sad time, because we were fighting to try and stay in the army, but it was also a fun and fascinating time. There were five of us amputees, and we all helped each other. There was a natural bond, because we'd all lost limbs. There was a lot of black humour too, calling each other a one-legged git, or nicking each other's prosthetic limb and hiding it. We did all sorts of silly stuff. Broke into the gym one night and put a load of stink bombs under the mats where the chief physical training instructor would stand. The next day, an awful ammonia smell rapidly filled the place. In the end, they had to stop the lesson, evacuate us and open all the doors. It was childish, really. But I think at the time, it was a way of coping with what we were going through and what we knew was going to happen, which was being medically discharged from the army. We knew it was coming, but none of us wanted it. It's harsh. The army fights wars and is good at it, but it's not so good at the back stuff. What you soon realise is that it's your relatives and friends who have to pick up the pieces, and if not them, the charities. The Royal British Legion, Blesma, Combat Stress, St Dunstan's, who helped the blind ex-servicemen and women. Help for Heroes didn't exist at that time. That was basically my motivation for wanting to raise money for Walking with the Wounded, because I'm acutely aware how difficult it is for men and women from the services to rebuild their lives after such a life-changing event. In the 15 years since I lost my leg, I've met hundreds of amputees, and I'm humbled by a lot of them. I know one guy, for example, who's a double amputee who also lost an eye. He was injured in 89 in Northern Ireland, and he was completely forgotten about. He fell through the system. He was militarily discharged, and that was that. He was on his own. But he's managed to rebuild his life. He is married and had several kids. I never once heard him moan. Not once. That is the attitude of a lot of the guys. Mine was like that to start with too. I was back riding a motorbike the January after I'd lost my leg. Headley Court went mad. They tried to nick my keys and hide my crash helmet. I set myself challenges. 2 years later, in 1996, I ran the London Marathon. I wanted to prove to myself and also my friends and family that I was okay, that I'd got over the loss of my leg and of my army career. But the truth was, deep down inside, I hadn't. The day after I was discharged, I applied for a job at Sea France, loading the ferries. You're basically a car park attendant, taking tickets, directing cars to the top deck or bottom, on your feet all day. I was absolutely crapping myself when I went for the interview. I thought that if they found out about my leg, they wouldn't employ me. So I did the best walk I could, didn't say anything, and I got the job. About 3 months later, I told them, and they were gobsmacked. But they didn't sack me. I proved I could do the job. About 5 years after my injury, I had a really black period. I was angry. I was depressed. I was drinking too much. One Sunday, my parents, my mum and stepdad, invited me round for dinner. "We're worried about you," they said. "You're not yourself." "I'm fine," I said. "Leave it. I'm all right." I was halfway through my dinner and I started crying. I couldn't stop and I didn't know why. The three of us decided I needed some help. So I took myself off to a hospital that specialises in mental health problems, Ticehurst House in Sussex. I only did a 2-week programme, post-traumatic counselling, but it was the best thing I could have done. Slowly, I turned myself round. A few years later, I was at a do in Aldershot, and I saw Sergeant Major Brown again. He got the Queen's Gallantry Medal for what he did that day. He was later commissioned and is now a major. Peter Inge is Field Marshal Lord Inge these days. It was about midnight, and we'd had a few beers. I saw Brown and I thought, I need to do this. So I went up to him and I said, Richard. He turned around and looked at me blankly. It's Rob Copsey, I said. Then he realised who I was. Yeah, he said. How are you? I'm fine, Richard, I said. I just want you to know that I'm fine and I don't hold any grudge against you. I put my hand out and he shook it. Then he nodded and turned and walked away. I think he was a bit choked, to be honest. I didn't see him again that night. He disappeared. But I felt relief for saying that. I needed to do it for me. Because feeling so angry and carrying it around for ages doesn't do you any good.
Chapter 4. A Prince at the Pole. In tandem with selecting the wounded men who were going to come to the North Pole with them, Ed and Simon were working hard on finding sponsors. Even going unsupported as they planned, they were looking at £200,000 to get themselves and two soldiers to the pole and back. They were both aware that it was a lot of money to raise and equally keen that donations should go 100% towards the wounded rather than on paying the costs of the expedition. At the end of January, Ed and his nephew Harry Parker flew to Scotland to address an away day organised by Lloyd's Development Capital, a private equity company whose CEO had already expressed broad support for the idea of the charity. In his diary, Ed wrote, Harry hasn't flown since he was on a plane back from Camp Bastion under sedation, so the trip up north was a big deal for both of us. But I found the support and goodwill he received from so many complete strangers very encouraging. When the captain of the plane asked Harry what had happened to him and then congratulated him on still smiling, I felt a definite lump. People really do care about what these boys have done in our name. We were warmly welcomed by LDC, and Harry spoke about what it's like to be a soldier on the front line, something which I suspect was pretty alien to most of the 100 or so people in the room. He talked briefly about what had happened to him and the challenges that face the wounded as they try and prepare for a new future, all in a matter-of-fact way that had an enormous impact on those we were addressing. I spoke too briefly about the walk and the charity. I think they probably looked on me with pity and surprise. A 44-year-old planning to pull a sledge to the North Pole with no polar experience, sure. But when we talked about the charity, it definitely seemed to resonate. I often wonder, said Harry, just how much of it is me being an effective communicator and how much they're just gawping at me. Barely 6 months after being blown up, he'd only recently started walking without sticks. He had taken to wearing shorts so that his two iron legs were clearly on view. This wasn't because he was an exhibitionist, but because it made it easier to take off the prosthesis when it became uncomfortable. It also allowed passers-by to know what they were dealing with. I think it looks weirder if I've got trousers on. In London especially, people passing, going up the tube escalator or whatever, or otherwise going, come on, get out of the way. Harry was only slowly coming to terms with his new role as a wounded soldier. This injury really wasn't part of my big plan, but it's part of who I am now, so I've got to get on with it. I'm quite mindful that you can get pigeonholed. I really don't want to become this professional wounded person. I was happy to help Ed with his charity, but only because it was Ed, and I believe in what it's all about. While other approaches to possible sponsors were made, the organisers were not turning away any ideas for money raising. A friend of Ed's wife, Harriet, had suggested a series of support the walk lunches. We started off writing to 250 people, says Harriet, asking them to host a lunch, with the idea that those people then went home and had another lunch, so you get a pyramid of awareness building up, and hopefully also money. It was astonishing how it snowballed. Some people did coffee mornings, some did dinners, it didn't matter. It ended up raising a lot.
One thing which continues to amaze me, Ed wrote, is the enthusiasm and support people are giving us over this.
Another intriguing development was the possible involvement of Prince Harry, either to offer support for the expedition's press launch in March, or even, just possibly, to accompany the team for part of the walk itself. Degas had a friend in common with the Prince and had talked to him about the expedition at a social event.
It was Laurence Dallaglio's Eight Rocks party in Battersea. Harry was there with a mate. I went over to him and said, "Thank you very much for your support." He said, "I wish I could come with you." I said, "You're more than welcome." We laughed about it, and that was about it. But it was something that stayed in our minds. Wouldn't it be great to have Harry along? So Ed then went through the official channels.
"If we were able to have him join us from Barneo for the last degree," Ed wrote in his diary, "it would be fabulous for our publicity. I'm sure it would help gain more corporate sponsorship too. It seems there's a little horse trading going on. He either walks with us or he does the launch. My view is that he will hopefully do both, but we obviously mustn't push our luck too much. We're enormously lucky to have his support at all."
A second selection session at the Rifles Club at the end of February brought more possible candidates for the shortlist. A Welsh ex-physical training instructor was, Ed noted, thoroughly engaging with the grit and determination of 10 men. But he had an above-the-knee amputation, something the selectors were cautious about, as the lack of mobility and the energy required to walk without a knee was significantly greater. The clincher was that he had sustained his injuries in a motorcycling accident in Germany. Ultimately, Ed and Simon felt that the expedition had to be about soldiers wounded on operations.
"It will be agony telling him he's not coming," wrote Ed, as he was so up for it.
A place, however, was to be offered to Matt Kingston, a Royal Marine who had lost a leg below the knee after he was shot through the ankle during a firefight near Afghanistan's Kajaki Dam. In the 2.5 years since he'd been wounded, Matt had, on a prosthetic limb, run the London Marathon, cycled to Paris, and climbed Mount Everest to Base Camp 1.
"Following this last session," Ed wrote, "we now have our shortlist of 4, and it's a really good mix. 3 below knee amputations and 1 lame arm as a result of a gunshot wound to the shoulder. More encouragingly, we have 2 officers and 2 other ranks, a para and a bootneck, a cavalry officer and a customs officer. While 3 were wounded in Afghanistan, 1 was wounded a few years back in Rwanda. So not all the emphasis is on today. Who will or won't come? Already I know the decision which 2 to take will be a horrible one. For the moment, I remain a little concerned that Martyn Hewitt, who was shot in the shoulder, might have difficulty with his arm. He has limited nerves and blood flow in it, and I fear there is a real danger that he could sustain cold damage without knowing. We do have a duty of care to these guys, and we mustn't take undue risks."
Fortunately, the expedition had been offered expert help in making these tricky but essential assessments. Ed had successfully approached the Institute of Naval Medicine at Alverstoke in Hampshire, which, in addition to its work for the fleet, is an internationally recognised centre for maritime and occupational health advice, training and research, with such intriguing-sounding departments as the Submarine and Radiation Medicine Division and the Diving and Hyperbaric Medicine Division, as well as the world's only cold clinic where tests on individual suitability for extremely cold environments are routinely run. In early March, Ed, Simon, Inga Solheim, Henry Cookson, Rob Copsey and Matt Kingston presented themselves at the Institute. Martyn Hewitt was away in Canada skiing at the Paralympics, and Guy Disney was on an army course, but the nucleus of the Walking with the Wounded squad was there.
"It was the first time we'd seen Rob and Matt since the initial interviews," wrote Ed, "and it felt great having a day together, starting to form into a team. We were amazed after we arrived to be shown into a small room where we were greeted by no less than 7 staff. We were all rather nervous as we thought that we were going to be dunked into the cold pool, but luckily that wasn't in store for us."
Instead, the group had their body mass, blood pressure and lung capacity measured before being rigged up to an electrocardiograph ECG machine to test heart fitness. Next up was the VO2 max test, which involves pedaling on an exercise bicycle with a tube in your mouth while your body's capacity to transport and use oxygen is analysed.
"This meant absolutely nothing to me," Ed wrote, "but it was explained that we would each in turn have a session on the bike. Every minute the resistance is increased. The plan is to keep pedaling at a constant rate until you can't pedal anymore. Inga, our Norwegian guide, went first. None of us knew what was a good or a bad performance, although we all assumed Inga was in pretty good shape. I was second. Bear in mind that I went for my first run just over 2 years ago when I decided it was time to get fit again, and during that run I had to walk after only 0.5 mile. Since then I've run a fair amount and been training hard in the gym, but this was the first time I'd been physically tested since leaving the army in 1992. I started off okay, but as the minutes progressed it got harder and harder. but our team and all the medics were watching, urging me on. I went through Inga's tie, much to my surprise, and felt there was still something in the locker. So I kept going, and managed a couple more minutes before I hit the wall. One should never brag, but by Jiminy, I ended up with the longest time and the highest score. On a day when the competitive nature of us all was reawakened, it felt fantastic. During the drive back to London with Dags, I was delighted to do a little nose-rubbing. More important than Ed's personal triumph, perhaps, was the assessment of the capability of the two wounded members for the cold weather training and selection in Svalbard in May. Matt Kingston was deemed to have sound overall fitness and good balance and strength in both his legs. When Rob Copsey took his turn on the VO2, however, it became apparent that he had developed a habit of favouring his left leg over his damaged right. Questioning by the medical team revealed that he had never been offered or received any physiotherapy since his injury. Despite his many physical achievements since then, including the running of marathons, Rob had effectively been using one leg, but both men were past fit to go. A discussion between the organisers and the head doctor, Dr. Dan Ruiz de Sá, about one of the two absent candidates, however, was less positive. As Ed had thought, Martin Hewitt's injuries meant that the blood circulation in his right arm would be poor, while as a result of nerve deterioration, there was a strong possibility that he wouldn't be able to feel any cold damage as it occurred. This was a real danger, a risk that the organisers might not ultimately be able to take. Back at their various home bases, the team put into practice the advice they had been given by both the Institute and Inga. In addition to regular runs and gym sessions, they were also encouraged to drag tyres, this being the best agreed method of building up the core strength necessary to pull sledges for hours at a time across the snow-covered ice pack of the North Pole. The alarming reality of what they had let themselves in for was indeed growing on Ed. One evening, he went with his wife Harriet to a talk given by Tom Avery, an explorer and author who had been to both poles, breaking the record for the fastest ever trip to the South Pole by using kites. He had also replicated the North Pole expedition made by Peary and Henson back in 1909, using similar dog teams and wooden sledges. Peary's claim to have reached the pole has long been disputed, but Avery's experience made him believe that it might, after all, have been genuine.
"While Tom was telling us about the South Pole," Ed wrote, "there was something a little mundane about it. But when he started talking about the North Pole, he instantly became animated. It was the more challenging of the two, he said, more nerve-wracking, more unrelenting. He spoke of its beauty, its remoteness, of it almost being alive. Then of standing briefly on top of the world, something that I have an ever-increasing desire to do. As I watched and listened to him, I felt a thrill welling up, a hint of adrenaline, and definitely some anticipation and apprehension. But what I saw was a place I now really wanted to go. In contrast, next to me, poor Harriet was watching with complete horror. As Tom spoke of the dangers from polar bears, the open water leads, the moving ice and the cold, I think she became more and more frightened about what is to come. She has to think not just of herself, but of the children back here too. She has to imagine the worst-case scenario, and listening to Tom, she heard many different instances which weren't good. To start with, says Harriet, Tom talked about the South Pole. Then he said, anybody thinking about going to the North Pole faces death every day. I almost gagged. I made this extraordinary noise. He then showed us some quite graphic photographs of pressure ridges and leads and dogs falling into them and having to be hauled out. There was one picture of a tent with a lead underneath it that had opened up overnight. So they'd woken up to find themselves either side of it. It was a very interesting lecture, but it made me realise that this was actually an incredibly hostile place to go and a dangerous thing to do. And was my husband mad?
On our way home, Ed wrote, Harriet asked a very wise question. How would you feel if it was me going? Which was incredibly difficult to answer. I think my first feeling would be to protect the children from it all. Then an element of anger about her selfishness in embarking on such a trip. Does the fact that we are doing this for the wounded impact on the decision? Of course. But there is still a very personal side to all this. Dags told me recently that the hardest bit of his South Pole trip was saying goodbye to his family. I know it will be the same for me.
But by now, Ed knew there was no going back. The beast he and Simon had created already had its own life. The official press launch at the Rifles Club in Mayfair on the 19th of March only took things a step further, especially as Prince Harry had now agreed to come down and lend his support. By this stage, Ed and Simon had a PR agency on board. Captive Minds had come recommended by Inga Solheim, as they'd worked on an expedition he had been involved with a couple of years before. Its directors, Marcus Chidgey and Alex Rayner, initially agreed to work pro bono. Now Marcus swung into action.
"Creating the right scene," says Alex, "having the right backdrops, the right messaging."
The agency took Rob Copsey down to his hometown of Dover and filmed him dragging three big black tyres across the pebbly beach, his prosthetic leg exposed underneath a pair of black shorts, balancing himself with ski poles. It was a powerful piece of footage that was shown across several TV networks. "There was a very quick turnaround," says Marcus. "From the day we met Ed and Dags to them being given a date by Clarence House, it was set up so rapidly, in fact, that we were making the warm-up video overnight." For Ed, the launch day began at 5:40 a.m. with a taxi to BBC Television Centre for an appearance on the BBC Breakfast programme. He and Rob Copsey were joined on the crimson couch in the studio by a bearded Inga Solheim, who provided the voice of experience to balance the enthusiastic novices. Breakfast Television led to the World Service, then to Channel 5 and on. By the time Ed arrived at the Rifles Club at lunchtime, the outside broadcast units were double-parked down Davis Street. Dags was as surprised as his fellow organiser by the turnout. "We thought that there might be a couple of photographers and maybe a freelance cameraman who could flog something to the BBC. But then the phone started ringing and the BBC wanted to be there and ITV and Sky wanted to do live broadcasts and there were all these bloody great satellite trucks on the street outside and we were kind of going, whoa." "We were given the nod by Clarence House," says Alex Rayner, "literally the day before, that Harry might be quite keen to go along on the expedition. That meant the media interest did get very excitable the night before." The Prince got to his feet at the centre of a lineup, which included Ed, Simon, Inga, Rob and Matt, and told the gathered press, as expected, that he was absolutely thrilled to become patron of this wonderful expedition. But at the end of his short speech came the bombshell.
"You'll be glad to know, maybe,"
he said in characteristically self-deprecating style,
"that if my military commitments allow me, I would love to join the team. I hope to join for maybe 5 days before the end if I'm allowed, and invited."
He grinned at the organisers, Ed and Simon on his left.
"Hopefully,"
he went on, turning to Matt and Rob on his other side,
"I'll be able to keep up with you guys, otherwise it'll be fairly embarrassing. Let's get an army flag on the North Pole before my brother lands a helicopter there."
The laughter that followed was drowned out by the sound of journalists reaching in handbags and jacket pockets for their BlackBerries. If all went well, this would in due course make for the kind of headline that tabloid sub-editors dream about, a prince at the pole. And sure enough, the next morning, the Daily Mail led with, "Heave ho, Harry! Prince prepares to join the walking wounded in trek to North Pole." "After everyone went home," says Simon, "I was down in the garage in the basement with Ed, and there was a moment of silence. And then we looked at each other and said, 'Jesus Christ, what was all that about?'"
"The single most inspiring moment of the day," Ed wrote in his diary, "was when my mobile rang again for the umpteenth time, as Harriet and I were driving back to Norfolk. A man who had lost his leg to diabetes phoned me to say how proud he felt about what we were doing. He acknowledged he wasn't a military amputee, but he thought that we will act as an inspiration to all amputees. To be able to get the attention of people like this, and for it to mean something to them, means a whole lot more than I would have expected. Walking with the wounded is now real, very real. No pulling out now, just pulling to the pole. Hoofing, as Matt would say."
The success of the launch had an immediate impact. TV production companies were falling over themselves in their keenness to make a film about the expedition. Meanwhile, the BBC security correspondent Frank Gardner expressed a desire to cover the continuing news side of the story. He had been a Territorial Army officer for 6 years and was himself confined to a wheelchair after an attack by Al-Qaeda sympathisers while on assignment in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. "We were literally deluged with TV companies saying they would love to do the documentary," says Marcus Chidgey. "We felt that the TV deal could be a big fundraiser for the charity, so Dags and I went round a load of different companies to see what sort of people they all were and how they might handle it." "Dags was wary," says Alex Rayner, "that the TV side might overshadow the enjoyment of undertaking the expedition."
Sometimes, adds Marcus, you can get the wrong TV crew. They might dramatise something that doesn't actually happen. They want to create a story that isn't there. That was definitely a concern.
The interest from sponsors also picked up dramatically. Several new names had seen the TV coverage and were now keen to get involved. None of this could come too soon. As Ed put it with his usual honesty,
there's a certain funding issue in the short term. We're starting to spend money, and neither Dags nor I have very deep pockets. We do need to start getting sponsors on board.
At the same time, numerous equipment suppliers had come forward offering free kit for the team, which would make yet more money available for the charity. At the start of April, the organisers received their first firm pledge of sponsorship, £25,000 from Elmfield Training, a UK-wide vocational training provider which had a special interest in the possibilities of working with wounded soldiers. The timing couldn't have been better. The money would be more than enough to finance the final selection process in Svalbard in May. Shortly after that, Lloyd's Development Capital, the firm Ed and Harry Parker had spoken to in January, committed to a generous contribution. Then Ed and Simon were invited to lunch by London-based fund manager Artemis. Before the pair could even roll out their presentation, they were offered a minimum of £50,000. Later that week, Carillion, the property company, committed to £40,000. Then came a call from international financial brokers BGC Partners, who had once been part of Cantor Fitzgerald, the company which had lost so many of its employees during the horrific events of September the 11th, 2001, all 658 who were in its offices on the 101st to 105th floors of the World Trade Center perished on that day. Since then, both firms had donated all profits from a single day's trading in September to the bereaved families and to other nominated charities both in the UK and in the US at over £10 million, a figure not to be sniffed at.
Dag said they were interested in getting involved in a big way, wrote Ed, but apparently wouldn't go over £500,000. What? I think we might be about to find ourselves a headline sponsor.
Meanwhile, the guys from Captive Minds had worked with Henry Cookson to create a Facebook page, something no respectable charity or expedition could now afford to be without.
It was interesting, says Alex Rayner, that we put our social media sites up about 3 days after the Rifles Club event almost as an aside. Within 72 hours of it going live, we had 6,500 members. That is a very quick build. We've done stuff for Premiership rugby clubs that has taken a year to do that.
Martyn Hewitt had now returned from the Canadian Paralympics, and Guy Disney had finished his training course, so there was a chance for the four candidates to finally meet around a table with the organisers.
On Monday, Ed wrote, I received a call from Matt asking me how important it was for him to attend the meeting. Very, I said. It transpired that he had run the London Marathon the day before, and after 10 miles, something in his foot had gone ping. Being Matt, being a bootneck, that didn't mean the end of the run for him. He ran and walked for the next 16 miles in excruciating pain in order to finish. A bit of me was very unimpressed. Matt informed me that the longest run he had done prior to the marathon was only 3 miles, which is simply ridiculous. Who runs the marathon having only run 3 miles? Well, Matt. And bearing in mind he is one down in the leg department, it's simply extraordinary. Why had Matt potentially compromised our expedition? But if you think about it in a little more detail, here is a man who's lost his leg, who's showing everyone he can still do it. From our perspective, maybe we should be encouraged that this extraordinary guts and determination exists in one of our team, but we must also ensure that Matt doesn't come north having only pulled his tyres a mile or two. The meeting, over plates of sandwiches and glasses of Coke and beer in one of the boardrooms of the Rifles Club, was a success. The dynamics between the four of them seemed good, Ed wrote. Martyn and Matt will compete, being a para and a marine, although Martyn might need to be told to shut up from time to time. Guy is considered and clearly sizing the others up, and Rob remains the mature, solid, ambitious core to the four. I felt that they are all very much up for the task, although we do need to ensure that for the next 12 months this is the single most important part of their lives. We need 100% commitment. Next stop, Svalbard. Cold and remote enough to give the team a taste of the conditions they would be experiencing in just under a year's time. All four wounded soldiers were going, plus organisers Ed and Simon, polar guides Inga Solheim and Henry Cookson, and prosthetics expert Jamie Gillespie,
with a specific brief to see how the three artificial legs would handle the low temperatures. Trailing them at a distance would be Alexis Giraudet and Rob Leverett, cameraman and soundman from 2-4 Broadcast, the TV company that Dags, Ed and Captive Minds had finally selected from many rivals to make the documentary film of the expedition. As well as winning Best Independent Producer at the 2010 Broadcast Awards, they had sound experience of filming in sub-zero conditions, having made the film On Thin Ice about Ben Fogel and James Cracknell's attempt to win the Amundsen South Pole race in January 2009. More important, they seemed to have the right attitude.
"They get it," said Ed.
To foster a spirit of competition, and for TV purposes, Ed and Simon had told the group that as originally planned, just two of the four soldiers would end up being selected for the final trip. But privately, both organisers were hoping that all four would prove up to the challenge. With substantial sponsorship in place and more in prospect, they could now afford to take a larger team than they had originally anticipated.
"I think Simon and Ed are being quite clever," said Rob Copsey a few days before they left for Norway. "They may already know what they're going to do, but we don't know that, so it's making us train and focus. It's going to be blimmin' hard, I think, especially the endurance ski march, but it'll be a really good taster to see if this is actually for us and if we really want to do it. And prosthetics-wise, it's going to be a big challenge. If the prosthetic isn't right or doesn't fit or you can't work with it in a cold environment, it isn't going to work. That's it. End of exercise. I'm going to be 40 if I get to go. A lot of these lads that are getting wounded now are 18. If they see a 40-year-old amputee can walk to the pole, maybe they'll say to themselves, 'Yeah, I'm going to be all right. If that old fart can do it with one leg, maybe I could do it next year.'"
Chapter 5. Would everyone please stop getting shot? Matt Kingston, Royal Marine.
I grew up on the beach in Clacton, which wasn't the nicest of places in the world. My dad was a fisherman, so I used to do a lot of fishing with him when I was younger. Then we moved to Norfolk and lived in an old abandoned watermill that we renovated as a family. When I was 17, Dad took over a ferry business. Takes foot passengers from King's Lynn to West Lynn and back again. After college, I went travelling. When I came back, I joined the Royal Marines. I'd always liked the idea of the military, and because of my background with my family, I put two and two together and the Marines were the result, soldiering with a maritime aspect. The 32-week course that all Royal Marines do is basically a commando course, which is one of the hardest courses, bar special forces, that you can do. In our troop, we started with 65 blokes and only between 12 and 14 finished. It's grueling and tough, but enjoyable at the same time. It definitely makes you proud to wear the green beret. It's great to be part of something that is so much of a brotherhood. There are only 6,000 of us within the whole military. In training, I was given a King's Badge, which is an award for best Marine in the troop. Because of that, I got promoted quite quickly. Within 6 months, I was a Lance Corporal, which saw me as second in command of an 8-man team in Afghanistan a year later. We flew out in September 2007. I was 22 at the time. Obviously, you have some nervous anxiety. We'd heard rumours that one in six guys was getting injured. But there's always the excitement of going out to do your job properly, because that's what you've been trained to do. There's a lot of difference between running around with a blank firing attachment on your weapon and running around with real bullets winging over your head. There's a joke within the Corps that if you've got your green beret on your head, you're bulletproof. Obviously, that isn't the case. But you do feel confident in your skills because you've been trained to such a high standard, and you know that the lads around you have too. The day that I was shot, we were fighting to protect the Kajaki Dam on the edge of the desert at the northern tip of the Green Zone. It was my first tour, and we were only 7.5 weeks in. We hadn't really seen that much action. We'd put the odd round down here and there, but we hadn't gone properly toe-to-toe with the enemy. Every time we got near them, we just dropped bombs on them. It wasn't sticking bayonets in people's heads. The mission that day was to reach the Flet. That's the forward-line enemy troops. Reach them, engage them, keep them at the distance they're at. Our main objective was to maintain a roughly 3-mile Taliban-free zone around the dam. There were three of us up on the roof of this deserted mud-brick building. Me, Ben, my machine gunner, and my grenade launcher, Smithy. We were protecting another troop who were ahead of us on the ground. At first, there wasn't much fire coming in. Just a few rounds, quite high, and not really anywhere near us, so we weren't too fussed. Then some started sneaking a bit closer. They were AK rounds, so we couldn't really see where they were coming from. It's hard enough finding anything in the desert, let alone where people are shooting from. The Taliban do a shoot-and-scoot technique, where they just fire through a hole in any wall they can find and then run on to the next one. You can't even see the muzzle flash. Then, a few rounds came in really close. Ben grabbed me and threw me back off the roof, into cover behind the building. As the dust settled, I felt this weird sensation in my foot, a warm, fuzzy feeling like someone had poured hot water on it. Ben said, "I think I've broken my ankle." I got up to help him, and as I stood on my foot, I felt a burning, horrible pain. I looked down, and I had two little red dots on either side of my desert boot. "Fuck it," I said, "I've been shot." "Shit," Ben said, looking down at his boot. "So have I." We yelled up to Smithy, who was still on the roof. Complete silence. For a moment, we just stared at each other. At that point, we both reckoned he was dead. I shouted back for a medic and the rest of the team came up. There was a bit of banter and a bit of laughter because it was like that scene in Lock, Stock and Two Smoking Barrels when the guy says, "I've been shot," and the other guy says, "Would everyone please just stop getting shot?" One of our boys got up on the roof to see what had happened to Smithy. He was alive, but he'd been hit in both legs, through his Achilles in one and the back of his calf in the other. The Taliban had caught us by coming round the side where we had no cover. They'd flocked up and shot all three of us in a line on the roof in one burst of fire, all on the lower limbs, luckily. I don't suppose that's what they were aiming for. Somehow, we had to get out of there. It takes four guys for each injured man, because all your kit and equipment has to go as well. Extra link for your machine gun, extra ammo, extra grenades, mortar rounds, water. You're carrying 80, 90, 100 pounds with you. For the three of us being extracted, that's 12 others to carry us, which means 15 blokes from a 30-man troop are out of the battle. The Taliban weren't going to miss an opportunity like that. They surrounded us in a 300-degree arc and hit us with everything they'd got. There were over 27 firing points confirmed by the helicopters on that day. We were basically pinned down until the Apaches turned up, and Camp Bastion was 40 minutes away. In the meantime, we were crawling, hopping, getting dragged, doing whatever we could to try and get out of that situation. We were all of us a magnet for bullets. At one point, I remember lying behind a 3-foot-high wall, and the rounds were zinging over the top. I was trying to get a cigarette out of my shirt pocket, and I thought, we're all fucked. There is no way we can get out of this. Then another guy, a marine engineer who was with us, got shot in the front of the leg. So that was four of us down. The Chinook, which was going to be taking us out, couldn't get any closer than a kilometre or so. CH-47s are susceptible to fire from the ground. Plonk one down in the middle of a firefight to put casualties in, you lose a helicopter. So they have to come down somewhere else, wherever it's free from fire. Which meant putting us on ladders, stretchers, whatever the guys could get, then running the distance with us. They were just phenomenal that day. They carried us to the point where they were being physically sick with the exertion. Rounds were still coming in at us, but they just cracked on. Finally, they managed to get us on a quad bike and take us down the wadi to the chopper on a trailer. Once all four of us were up on the Chinook, the medics gave us gas for the pain. Believe it or not, as we sat there, sipping from a nozzle, Ben and I were laughing. How the fuck did...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.